Hey guys, we are back for chapter 14 of Finding Langston. The last chapter was kind of crazy. Langston was at the library and he ran into Clem, who's one of those bullies. And the library is kind of a surprising place to see Clem. And we found out that Clem goes to the library once or twice a week or something like that. And Langston's having some weird feelings about it, and he's worried that he's going to tell Lyman and then he's going to get bullied even more. So let's see what happens in chapter 14. Here we go. Turns out Miss Fulton ain't no trouble at all, almost like she took a vacation from herself. After being alone with Daddy for so long, I ain't used to this much talking, but it ain't so bad. I figure her living alone makes her want to talk. Besides, her food is so good, her steady talking gives me more time to eat. And she is pretty, prettier than I thought at least. Her skin is smooth and her eyes light up when she's telling a story. Her hair is pulled into a bun on top of her head, and she has those pearl earrings I've seen rich ladies wearing. My mama didn't even have her ears pierced. She said she wouldn't waste her money on earrings. But Miss Fulton's earrings and hair and proper talk make her look like a real lady. She teaches English at Dunbar High School, born and raised in Chicago, got two sisters and one brother. She talks so much I could write her biography. All your folks live in Chicago? I ask between mouthfuls, just to keep her talking so I can keep on eating. Funny you ask, she said, getting up from the table. She brings over one of the pictures she keeps in a frame. These are my parents, Anne and Albert Fulton. They came here from the South, like you, only from Charlottesville, Virginia. But I was born here, the oldest of four. My parents still live at 45th and St. Lawrence. She looks proud and keeps staring at the picture. So your brothers and sisters live in Chicago? I reach for another spoonful of rice, and Miss Fulton doesn't even notice. My brother William lives in Indiana with his family, but my sisters are here. One is at Crane College over on the west side, and the other is a teacher like me. I nod. Sounds to me like she comes from a real smart family. You always wanted to be a teacher? For as long as I can remember. I've always loved reading, so I didn't know what else to be. After I finished high school, I enrolled in college, just part-time at first. Looks like Miss Fulton been waiting for me to ask this question. Her eyes are bright, and she's leaning toward me in her seat. I had an aunt who was also a teacher, and she encouraged me to get an education degree. So that's what I did, and now Miss Fulton acts like she doesn't remember because she starts counting on her fingers. This will be my 10th year teaching. What kind of books does your class read? 2 more years before I'm in high school, and I'm already counting the days till I get out of Haynes Junior High and away from Lyman. We just started a unit on poetry, she tells me. That makes me put down my fork. Poetry? Yes, she answers and walks over to a small bookcase in the corner. Stacked on top are magazines she sets on the floor, some with pictures of black folks on the cover. I'd like to get a look at ones with names like Life, The Crisis, and Ebony, but I'll have to ask Miss Fulton another time. Never even noticed any of this before, probably because I was too busy smelling her lavender smell. Of course, the school likes me to teach all the classic poets, Emerson, Frost, Dickinson, but I always include some of our own as well. Paul Laurence Dunbar, for one, she says, opening one of the books she sets on the table, turning to the first page to the list of poets. So, all these are colored poets? I look down at the list of names I've never heard of. Yes, they are. Many are from the Harlem Renaissance, and some, she turns the page, are right here in Chicago. My head is trying to keep everything straight. Harlem. I know that from reading the biography. Harlem, New York? I ask, but really telling because I want her to know I know a little something. Exactly, she says, brightening up the room again with her smile. I go back to looking at the names. Arna Bontemps, Gwendolyn Brooks. I know these names from the library pictures. County Cullen, W.E.B. Du Bois, Jesse Fawcett. These I don't. Right away, I see Mr. Langston Hughes. You'll be reading Langston Hughes? I ask. Oh yes, he's one of my favorites. She smiles some more. In fact, she says serious now, I heard him read one of his works not too long ago at the Hall Library. We have a wonderful lecture forum run by the librarian there. Do you know his work? I suppose. I don't know how much I want to be telling Miss Fulton. Me and the library and books and Mr. Langston Hughes are something I'm keeping to myself. Maybe I'll read something of his after dinner, she says. If you want, I say, hoping she can't see how much I want to hear her read. I help her scrape the plates, wash and dry the dishes, and then we sit at the table and Miss Fulton picks up the other book. Its pages are worn and old. Some are just about to fall out. Some have folded down corners, but she finds the page she's looking for and starts reading. The Negro Mother. Children, I come back today to tell you a story of the long, dark way. I close my eyes, listening. Her words sound even prettier without me stumbling over them in my head. Miss Fulton reads in a way that sounds like she's singing a song. Langston, are you awake? She asks. Yes, Miss Fulton. I open my eyes. Oh, you looked like you were asleep. She keeps on. I make my eyes stay open and watch her mouth sound out each word, making them sing. Finally, she finishes. I don't care what she thinks now. Can you read that one more time? I ask her. How about I read another? She says, flipping to one of the turned down pages. No, that one, please. I think she sees something in my face that says I need to hear it again, because she doesn't ask any more questions, turns back the pages, and starts again. When I lie in my bed that night, I think about Grandma and how I never got a chance to say goodbye. When Mama passed, Grandma told me Mama is always going to be my guardian angel. She'll be looking out for you wherever you go, she said, so don't go shaming her. Respect yourself and everyone around you, and you'll make her proud. I nearly cried myself to death thinking about Mama up in heaven, all alone, but now Grandma will be with her. The both of them are my guardian angels. First night I came to Chicago, First night since I came to Chicago, the night sounds are quiet. No music from next door, no loud talking on the stoop. Even the rats scratching in the wall are quieter. After Miss Fulton's reading, I don't want to hear my voice reading tonight. I'm just holding on to hers. But I remember the name from the pictures and in the book, and as soon as I leave school tomorrow, those are the ones I'll be looking for in the library. That was kind of a happy chapter. We really needed to hear that. So he really likes the poem, The Negro Mother. Why do we think that is? I don't know. We'll find out. Chapter 15. Bye, guys.